This episode is brought to you by the Fitzroy Art Collective, the heart of Melbourne's art scene.
Coming to you from the colourful and smoky stage of the internet, this is the Mellow Dramatics. Three insane minds discussing all things theatre. Now, chookers, and let's start the show.
Hello and welcome to the Mellow Dramatics podcast. You make the theatre rules and we will break them. Firstly, remember that these are just our opinions. Secondly, our opinions are law. On today's episode, we discuss six movies that should be plays. Later, we'll be rewriting Mamma Mia. And finally, we'll be heading to the Bikini Bottom to check out SpongeBob the Musical. Please like and subscribe, or don't. You have free will. I'm not your dad. But remember, if you don't subscribe, some poor actor will have to perform in a play we write.
Most likely us. We will have to perform in a play that we write.
I am your host, the L. Woods of the Melodramatics, Benji Rag, here with the Vivian Kensington of the Melodramatics, Lauren Huggard.
Thank you.
It's from Legally Blonde. And the Professor Callahan of the Melodramatics, Dia Taylor.
Thank you. I haven't seen it in so long.
Is
so
that the one that like sleazes on her?
Yes.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, that's actually fitting. So
these are the old
casting
couch of the legal world.
It's so creepy.
Yeah. Hey, I am a sleaze, apparently.
Hey, Benny, you called us by the wrong names on the screen. That's your name says something else.
What does my name say, Lauren?
I don't like to use that language.
Exactly.
Benji is the see you next Tuesday.
Of Sneakyville.
Yeah.
Which is very true.
So how are we going, guys?
I'm the most talented. We are going fantastic.
Pretty Wait, you're good. The most talented out of all of us? On what scale?
I clearly am. On the normal scale.
Is
of
it
talent?
Because she's the newbie that she's fresh?
I am fresh and haven't been torn down by the realities of theatre just yet.
Well, you're certainly not the one who does
Still
the most work.
Learning, I am a student of theatre. I have not done theatre properly since high school, so it's all a learning curve for me. It's
I
nice.
Think
it's
when you're drunk, it's
film.
Okay to, you know, try a little bit of thespianism.
You know what? Usually when I am drunk, I do tend to act mellow, be a melodramatic. There we go.
I'd mimic SpongeBob's laugh, but I don't know.
What is it?
Sorry, we're going to be talking about SpongeBob.
That's so weird. It's almost like Lauren knew that.
It's like I can see the future.
Both stage and screen have a history of borrowing from each other, from the acclaimed adaptation of Cat in a Hot Tin Roof to the masterful creation of the Evil Dead musical. We see stories travelling across both stage and screen frequently. So today, we're going to take it upon ourselves to pitch the next big musical or play adaptation. We're hoping these will be more Shrek the Musical and less Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark. We really shit on that film a lot, don't we? I mean, that play a lot.
Yeah. That's our scale now. Shrek to Spider-Man. I like it.
Oh. I dig it.
And, you know, of course, after this, we do expect the, you know, the Academy to give, you know, to give us our Tonys.
By suggesting an idea?
Yes. I mean, I don't want to write it. Someone else is going to write it.
Okay, they're just going to give you an award for an idea. Right. Yes. Well, you know, sure.
Don't think that's how it works. But
I wish it was that easy.
Things are different with COVID.
makes so much sense.
Touché. Touché.
So in 1984, guys, one of the scariest movies ever released was released.
Wow.
I should write a script.
What are you Englishing?
I'm talking, of course, about Nightmare on Elm Street. A classic film in which Johnny Depp falls into his bed and has a period.
Oh, yeah.
Where a burnt sausage of a man murders teenagers.
See, these do make sense.
If you've seen the movie.
Strangely enough.
Where the main heroine has a lot of mummy troubles.
Lauren's just like, what the heck is this film?
Lauren, you haven't seen Nightmare on Elm Street, have you?
No.
All right, I'll give you a quick recap of it without too many spoilers. So there's a group of teenagers, and one of them complains that she's seeing a man in her dreams, and he's hurting her. And then, shock and horror, they're all seeing this man, and she gets, like, brutally killed by, like, getting thrown up on the roof by Freddy. And, yeah, Nancy, her best friend, starts, like, investigating it and finds out her parents murdered a guy because it's never explicitly said that he was a child molester in the film, but he definitely murdered children.
Yeah, I think they just, like, thought he was.
Yeah, anyway.
Like, you know what parents are like. The idea is...
He's not too happy about being, like, burnt alive, so it's never really explained how he comes back. But he comes back and he's hunting down the children in his dreams.
Oh, won't somebody please think of the children?
That reminds me of Star Wars, where, like, somehow Palpatine has returned. It's just like, somehow Freddy Krueger...
You know, we could do a review, like, really quickly of the latest Star Wars film. It was shit.
It's done. Terrible.
Haven't seen it? Don't care.
That's yeah.
So there's a lot of famous sort of horror moments in A Nightmare on Elm Street. It leans very heavily on special effects. And I think it'd be perfect for the stage.
Is that why you love it so much?
No, I like the atmosphere of it. It's beautifully acted.
It's okay. It's definitely, they're definitely actors, so, yeah.
John Saxon's in it. He's pretty decent.
But nothing beats Freddy versus Jason in terms of acting. Come on.
Yeah, Kelly Rowland.
Freddy versus Jason was my first horror film that I saw.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Really? Well, you already know what, like, Freddy Krueger does then.
You started at the bottom. Oh, Lord.
Really, dear? You were saying it was a fantastic piece of cinema.
It's called sarcasm. Oh.
What's that?
Yeah, there we go.
It certainly wasn't sarcasm. Any more terrifying than Cats.
That gives me nightmares.
Okay, so how I do it, guys, is I would have a sort of bare stage, you know, and things would sort of roll on. So I get, like, a lot of stage hands. So when we have, like, a scene in the bedroom, they would roll on, like, a whole set of a bedroom, and then we just roll it off. So that's how I'm going to get around, because there's an incredible amount of scene changes in this and location changes. Yes. And I'm just not going to be able to, like, you know. So everything will be on fucking rolly wheel, you know, fucking wheels. I'm not going to say people won't get injured making this, because there's going to be a lot of stunts.
So it would be Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark.
No, but it'll be good. I did think, like, the famous sort of blood scene, to do it the way they did it in the film, just strap a bed to the roof, have, like the roof of the theater, have the actor, like, hang on the bed, like, you know, and just have someone come out and grab him from underneath the bed, and then we'll just pour buckets of blood down onto the floor.
Okay.
Yeah. You're following? Yeah, cool. Yeah. In terms of the fire, I just think have fire on stage. Each night, will burn down the stage.
I just feel like that's a bad idea for RH&S reasons. I don't know. Yeah. You'd have to have a lot of...
Budget-wise.
Liability insurance there.
I feel that if Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark can kill a bunch of people, I can do the same.
Well, you know...
Love the logic.
Having Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark as sort of the bar isn't the best idea.
You know what? I think that, like, I can get this done for the low, low price of $80
million. Ah, oh, easy.
But I want Robert Engel to come back and reprise the role.
How old would he be now? He'd be, like, in his 80s or something, wouldn't he?
Yeah, he's getting close to it. Actually, funny story for number 5. In number 5, they wanted to... No, it was New Nightmare. They wanted to have a shot of all the actors who've been in every single Nightmare on Elm Street film at this funeral. And they got them all, pretty much. But, you know, one exception, Johnny Depp. And it's because Wes Craven felt that Johnny Depp would be, like, too much of a big-name actor now when he wouldn't, like, do it. And so, yeah, like, Johnny Depp, and he's like, no, I would have done it. I would have come down just to complete the whole cast.
Aww.
Yeah.
That's nice.
So, Lauren, what film are you going to drag onto the stage?
I really love The Hunger Games. So I think The Hunger Games should be a play.
The whole series?
This is going to be a long show.
I think Let's start with just the first one, The Hunger Games.
You could just condense the whole series.
And then we'll see how successful we are, and then you could do the whole series like they did in the films, where you would have individuals. So you wouldn't have, like, the whole play as every single one, because that would go forever.
Yeah.
So you would just have one play being the first, and then
There's a lot of...
Like Shrek,
there's
yeah.
a lot of fighting yeah. and forest in that. How are you going to get yeah. them onto this
stuff? So my thoughts is that the stage would be, like, set in the round. So kind of like a big arena, like the Colosseum or okay. something. And so that's representative of the arena of the Hunger Games in
Actually,
the film.
Yeah, you should probably explain a little bit of what the story is for those who don't know.
For those of you who don't know, The Hunger Games is based on the books by Suzanne Collins, and it's set in, like, a futuristic world where the whole world's kind of been destroyed, but there's one section that used to be North America that's left. They call it Panem. The capital of Panem then kind of, like, basically takes over as a dictatorship or whatever you want to call it.
So just and normal America.
Yeah. And so it's split into 12 districts, and the districts are, like, pretty poor, and they rise up against the capital, but they fail. And so then for punishment of that uprising, the capital create the Hunger Games. So they force each of the 12 districts to send two children into the arena, so a boy and a girl, to fight to the death for only one winner. And so they do that every year.
That's going to be the club after lockdown.
That's basically the Hunger Games.
So it's pretty much next year. That's
yeah, except eventually it changes. So what is it, the 75th Hunger Games, which the movie is based about, is when it all kind of changes. So Katniss, who's a kid in District 12, she volunteers as a tribute because her sister is chosen. And then she goes into the arena with a guy from her district. And he says he loves her.
Of course he does.
Falling in love, blah, blah, blah. And then they end up as the last two at the end. And he wants her to kill him and she doesn't want to kill him. So then they propose to, like, both eat poison berries and die together. And then there'll be no winner. But the capital, like, no, we have to have a winner, and, like, it's too tragic to see them die like that. So then they both win, and then there's a whole big drama, and that's how the other movies happen, with the falling out of that.
Spoilers.
See, now, if that was me, yeah. I would suggest we both eat the berries, but then I wouldn't do it.
There'd be a lot of
There can only be it. One yeah. winner. There can
be only one! So, yeah, how I would put this play on is the arena of the Hunger Games, where they all fight to their death. I would have it like the stage in the center and the audience all around it, so they're kind of like watching the fighting, thinking kind of like the Colosseum, like how they used to have the
that'd be a good setup for it, actually.
Gladiators.
Yeah, like the gladiators. And then the fighting is pretty easily to be staged.
You could get a member of the audience
in the movie
as one of the people and kill them on stage.
I mean, you could, but there's lots of liability around that.
What is it with you and death and theatre? Oh. There's a theme going here. Are you feeling
I
okay?
I
want
to get back to the old Roman
murder.
Style of theatre.
Oh, where they just murder each other. Yeah. Why not?
And so in the film, the dead bodies of the kids, they get taken out of the arena by, like, a hover thingy. Hovercraft? Whatever you want to call it. So my idea would be that they would just be put on wires and lifted out of the... Where what did I say we're performing the Colosseum? Yeah, yeah. And then, like, you could use projections for, like, showing the count of the dead bodies, how they do in the movie. Basically, go watch the movie and see how great it is and how great it would be as a play, but it would be very difficult and very expensive to put on.
Yeah, I just imagine, like, someone's wiring getting stuck and they're, like, you know, hanging in front of the audience, and they just have to pretend to be a dead body the entire show.
Yeah, it would be Spider-Man turn off the dark level if something went wrong.
Lol.
Yeah. Okay, dear. What masterpiece
yes.
will you be gracing Broadway with?
First, I'm going to have to say the 2017 film called The Death of Stalin.
Very good film.
Directed by Armando Iannucci. I can't pronounce his name. So pretty much what The Death of Stalin is about sort of the USSR and what happens to their government after Stalin has died. So Moscow, 1953, after being in power for nearly 30 years, Soviet dictator Joseph Stalin takes ill and quickly dies. Now the members of the Council of Ministers scramble for power. So
it would be a great comedy.
Yeah, it's a pretty interesting film. So yeah. It's just basically these four or five ministers, like Michael Palin, Steve Buscemi and all that in it. And they just sort of like, it's all really bitchy. And they all want power, but they don't want the other guy to have power. And they're all like, they've been living in a dictatorship.
Yeah.
And so they're used to people randomly dying. And, like it starts off with there's this.
It's like the bitchiest versions of people getting killed.
Yeah, yeah. Anyway, so it starts off with this orchestra recital that's being played on the radio. And then all of a sudden, the radio gets a message from Stalin saying that he wants it recorded. And they're like, oh crap, we didn't record it. So they have to get everyone back in, and the conductor just passes out. So, yeah, and they force a recording, and it's, yeah. So pretty much, yeah, it's the four of them.
That really happened.
Yeah, I know. So it's based on real life, which is hilarious. So, yeah, how I imagine it being portrayed as well. Oh, it's also got Jason Isaacs, who I'm in love with at the moment. so how I...
I just remember the scene.
No, I really am.
When they're, like, doing the coup. And, like, Steve Buscemi walks up to Jason Isaacs and is like, so I'm thinking about killing this man. Do you reckon you could help me? And Jason Isaacs is just like, you realize I could get you killed for what you just said? It's like, well, let's forget. He's like, no, I'm in on it. No, we'll kill him. Don't worry.
Yeah, yeah. And I love it too because the whole cast are English actors mainly, and so instead of putting on like Russian accents, they're just like typical English guys having like very British style conversations. It's hilarious. Like you gotta really think that these are Russians, like tough strong Russians, but they're scrawny British guys. Anyway, what was I saying?
Actually, I gotta say my favorite part of that movie is just when Stalin dies, like outside the door there's just two Russian guards. And they, like, hear the thump.
Yes.
And one Russian guard just says to the other, he's like, should we, like, go in there and check if he's all right? And the other guy goes, you want to fucking die? Stand right there. And they just leave him for a couple of hours.
Yeah, and they don't move at all. No, it's hilarious. It's hilarious. Anyway, so the film itself is very comical and very sort of absurd. And so what I imagine is if anyone's ever seen The Accidental Death of an Anarchist by Dario Fo, yep. I sort of imagined it in that being portrayed in that way. So it still has the same sort of feel and themes to it. Obviously a lot would be cut down, especially locations, changing locations and all that. But the whole idea of both that film and that production is that, you know, it's around a singular incident in politics. And everyone has to try and figure, it's basically a very character driven story about characters who were freaking out around a particular thing. So, you know, one or two locations that it's all very, you know, it's farce. It's essentially farce. Okay. So that's how I imagine, Death of Stalin to be as a play. So yes, but definitely watch it.
It would lend itself easily to an opera.
I wouldn't say an opera as such. Operas are usually very dramatic, yeah. Even when they're comedic. This, I reckon, would be more of a farce than an opera.
Yeah. Okay, so you guys know of an obscure actor named Ryan Reynolds.
Benji Ragg?
I feel like I'm very well known.
I do know Ryan Reynolds. Yeah. And I think I know what film this is. I think I know what film this is because you told me to watch it, and I did.
Yeah.
And was it shit?
And I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Yeah, so he made a movie, Jesus, it would have been about 15 years ago. And yeah, it never made its money back, but it's gone on to get like a cult following. So in the movie, he plays a man who is completely mentally deranged. There's no question about it. He's insane. And he's fallen in love with a girl at work, but he doesn't take his medication. Because if he takes his medication, he sort of comes back into the normal world where everything is shit. But in the world in his mind without medication, everything is bright, colourful. His animals talk to him. Everyone's nice. There's sing-alongs and dances at work. As the sort of movie goes on and he gets further with this woman, he ends up accidentally killing her by running her in a tree and decapitating her. So in trying to cover it up, he ends up putting her head in the fridge and the rest of her body in Tupperware? It was Tupperware, I'm sure of it.
He doesn't decapitate her. He stabs her. He stabs her and then he cuts up the body in Tupperware, yeah.
Sorry. Wait, who else? It's the... there's another girl in it who's... she's really cute.
Anna Kendrick?
Yes. She's in it. She's a girl who, like, really has a crush on him. I believe that he ends up murdering her as well. Yes.
Yes.
There is literally a great... He ends up killing three women and decapitating them. And he puts all their heads in the fridge. And so there's this point where they're all, like, you know, yelling at him and gossiping that he, like, has to open up the fridge over and over again and tell them to shut up. It's an amazing movie. There's a great scene with his therapist where, you know, he's on the car and he's like, I don't understand why I'm like this. He's like, well, don't you understand? You're a psychopath. I'm like, oh, it all makes sense now. Finally, 12 years of therapy. So he, like, throws her in his house and, like, ties her up. And then she said, what am I going to do with her company? And now in his mind, the women's heads are talking to him all the time. So he just goes and grabs, like, one of the heads and just puts it on the table to keep her company.
Yeah.
But it's an amazing film, and it's one of the more darker, funnier horrors out there. But is it, like...
The voices.
Yes, it's the voices. I know from the description it sounds very bloodthirsty and horrific, but it is a very bright, funny film. Like, the color scheme is amazing. So I reckon it would be perfect in the style of a musical like Heathers.
Yes, especially
the sort of bright color, the dancing, the singing of everything.
Especially the dance number in the credits. I love that, like the costumes and everyone's so happy. Yeah.
But yeah, like I think even like the kill scenes could be done in a sort of musical number of, you know, because even him as the character, even in the film, he has huge movements. And that would just lend itself easily to stage. And as I said, like we've had Heathers, Mean Girls come up. I think the voices could be the next one. And like you can do decapitation on stage. We saw it last week in American Psycho. So Lauren, what film? Mm-hmm. What film is on the stage of your mind?
Well, I thought of a more family-friendly film than your ones. So this one is George of the Jungle. If you haven't seen it, it's basically the same story as Tarzan.
Brendan Fraser.
It was produced by Disney. Yeah. It's basically George disappears in the jungle when he's a kid and then gets raised by the gorillas. And then people come to the jungle and they try and make him be a civil human and lots of other stuff happens. Go look it up because I'm not great at summarizing.
Basically, you know, when you meet someone from Sydney and you try to, you know, introduce them to civilization.
Hey, I lived in Sydney for a while.
I thought you were going to say something else.
Yeah, touche.
So I guess the way I would stage it would be like... because George swings from the trees a lot with vines. So the stage would be very set, very green. Lots of pretty stuff that makes you think it looks like a jungle.
Yeah, I was going to say, instead of
the Lion King has puppets. Yeah. Instead of lions, Lion King's fake animals, all the animals will be real animals. Well, not real animals. I present people in animal costumes.
You're going to get like 16 gorillas on this stage again. What are you going to do?
You probably could have like an animatronic gorilla.
So I was going to say, whipped elephants to do what it, they're a little bit over.
Yeah, good times.
And so like they'd swing from wires.
Oh, I was going to say, who was it? It was the, like, the famous inventor who, like, murdered an elephant, wasn't it?
Well, we're not going to do that in George of the Jungle, the play. Okay. That's all I really had. I wasn't sure if we were doing a play or a musical. I thought this has potential to be a musical because, you know, there's music in the movie and, like, you could have the George of the Jungle theme song. But again, I'm not getting paid to make this, so I don't care about the logistics and how it would look.
You could do it like a Disney cruise show.
Yeah, that could work. Then you'll possibly get paid for it.
Do they have theatres big enough to have people swinging around in there?
I'm sure they'd find some. It's Disney. Disney are...
True. Yeah.
We'll do it off the back of a cruise ship. So every time off they the swing, they go it. Out into the ocean.
Once again, Benji is killing actors.
Yeah, but they're Disney cruise actors, so they're not good.
Oh, that's mean. Just... So originally I was going to do Knives Out, but after a second thought, I realized there's another film that I would really want to see as a play a lot more. It's one of my favorite films, made in 2007. It's the original Death at a Funeral by Frank Oz, mm-hmm. and written by Dean Craig. So it's a British film. Pretty much it's about a funeral where chaos sort of happens when a man tries to expose a dark secret regarding the recently deceased patriarch. And everyone tries to cover it up and whatnot. I'm not sure if it actually was a play at first, because it definitely has that feel. Like it's set in a singular... Yeah, like it's set in a singular location. And all the characters really bounce off one another. And yeah, it's just, it's fantastic. And, you know, it's simple and the jokes land every single time. Like you've got Matthew McFadden, you've got Alan Tudyk, you've got Rupert Graves, Peter Vaughan, and Peter Dinklage and all that. So it's got a great cast.
Just remember when they like had the father's coffin laid out, and they had to put Peter Dinklage into the coffin. And they, like, threw Peter Dinklage in there. And, like, you know, him and this body end up, like, in the 69 position. And and one of the sons goes, well, you know, we can't leave Dad like that. And then the other son goes, you know, in a strange way, it's probably what they both would have wanted.
Yeah. But no, like, it's just, it's really clever how, like, all these different characters are all, they're all the worst possible people.
Okay.
Alan Tudyk, yeah. Yeah, I know his character's okay. He's sort of the only good one that gets fed, like, you know, major hallucinogens by accident. It kind of has to deal with his fiancé's family sort of hating him. But no, and it's, you know, it's around a central idea. It's got sort of a moral sort of underlying theme that, you know, you can do it and be your own man and yada, yada, yada. So no, I would definitely see that as just a play. Once again, maybe something... Not quite as fast as accidental death of an anarchist, but something along those lines, definitely. But yeah, not a musical, just a normal play. Actually, so yeah,
you know, like what a really like fucked up idea would be of how you could do it.
Yeah.
Okay, rent a house. Stage the whole funeral and do it like a sight-based performance where you walk around the house and just have the actors just continually just walking around doing the story, and you're there just as sort of a person attending the funeral and seeing all this.
That would be cool.
I just hate things like that, as they just stick to the normal one. But hey, I mean, it sounds cool. I'm just old school. I'm like, ugh.
Yeah, you just
modern theater.
So Sneaky Villain doing a site specific performance next?
We'll see. Okay, we'll see.
I did want to do like a performance.
Just shoot that.
Where I'm a prostitute, and the whole thing takes place in a motel, and the customers pay to have sex with me.
That's not a performance.
That doesn't sound like a performance. That just sounds like your day job. So, I'm not sure.
I mean, you could call it performance art, but yeah.
Maybe feel like you play with fire and do a little dance or something. I don't know.
Oh, there was a woman who she got a grant from the Australian government to make an art piece, and her art piece was that she was gonna get sperm donated to her and inseminate herself live on webcam.
I may have misheard you there.
Ooh. And the government gave her money for this.
Well, when they found out what it was about, they actually, like, took the money away.
Why did they give her a grant? grant. You would have to do a grant application about what your thing is about
before
you get
money. Well, she is an artist. She did the art exhibit where she put wool up her her area.
Are you really?
Yes, and then when she got her period, she would pull the wool out and knit with it.
What the fuck, artists?
That doesn't sound healthy.
I get, you know, expression of self and all that, but, like, there's a line.
I mean, guys, a, line. A free sweater is a free sweater.
Yeah, but I've got my own period blood. I don't want to...
Dio would hate Marina Abramovich.
Oh, is that the lady with the dark hair and the red dress who sat across from people who were just, yes. like, yeah. stare at her? Yeah.
It's okay, dear. You're just very close-minded.
Yeah.
I am. Fuck you. I think I'm very normal-minded, and the majority of people would be with me going, what the fuck?
What are your thoughts, audience members, on performance art like this? And, you know, what would you like Dia to do?
What? No.
This is Donna Floor. She's married to Badinu. He gets killed and she is very sad, so she marries Dr. Tail. But then Badinu's ghost comes back and the fun really starts. See Saraba, Saraba, the new hot musical live at the Broadway Theater. Dancing in the aisles is definitely permitted.
Okay, so now we'll be looking at a play that has more ABBA songs in it than I have had croissants stuck up my rectum. Lauren, what is Mamma Mia?
It's not croissants being stuffed up your rectum, that's for sure.
Thankfully.
It's a jukebox musical based on the music of ABBA. And so Benny and Bjorn from ABBA were actually involved in the development of the musical, and they even play cameo roles in the film. Maybe, possibly both films, I can't remember. And so the storyline is, follows Sophie, who's a young girl, and she is getting married to her fiancé, Sky, but she wants her dad to be at the wedding, and she's never known her dad. And then she finds these old journals of her mum that talk about these three men who her mum knew when she was young and, you know, had some sexy times with them.
They're all incredibly attractive.
Yeah, they are.
Very lucky.
Pierce Brosnan, what a babe.
That's the one I'm going with.
Right?
So basically from those journals, she doesn't know which one her father is. So she invites all three of them to the wedding without telling her mum. And they rock up and lots of drama goes down. And then basically she doesn't get married.
Obviously, this is considered a little bit of a staple of musicals. And a lot of people reckon it's one of the sort of more... Well, it's one of the more popular musicals.
Yes.
But obviously we're three very talented individuals and we're great at writing. So we can take it upon ourselves to make this story better. So, dear... Tell me your version of Mamma Mia.
I'm first. Wow, how is it freezing over?
Well, it's self-serving if I go right. first and Lauren just talked.
I see. Okay, well, so I went with the whole idea of, you know, choosing between three, if that makes sense. Yeah, so I'm going with The Judgment of Paris, if anyone has ever heard of the Greek myth. or Paris and the Golden Apple, yada, yada, yada. So pretty much what it is golden apples were sacred in Mount Olympus in Greece, which is where the gods supposedly lived. There were presents from Gaia to Zeus and Hera on their wedding day. Gaia was essentially their mother, you know, the goddess of Earth. She essentially created the heavens and all that. And these apples could grant immortality, and anyone who ate them would never again experience hunger, thirst, suffering, or illness. So everyone wanted one, that's gods and humans included. And these apples were kept in a garden, guarded by, I'm bad at pronouncing, why do I always get the worst pronouncing? Hesperides, daughters of the goddesses of the night, and by Ladon, which was a 100-headed dragon that never slept. So anyway, there's this wedding, right? And Eris, the goddess of discord, she was furious at not having been invited to the wedding of Thetis and Peleus, I think it was. So she took one of the apples and threw it among the guests.
Fucking bitch.
And on the apple, and on the apple was inscribed the words, "To the fairest," essentially. And it caused mayhem among the crowd because you know what gods are like. They're all very self-serving. Now, Zeus is like, oh, crap. Okay, what are we going to do? I don't want to have to deal with this. Because his wife Hera and his daughter Athena and his daughter-in-law Aphrodite were like, I'm the fairest of them all.
And he's like, oh, guys, you're really eating into me shagging time.
Yeah, pretty much.
I need to go back down to Earth and can't be dealing with this.
Yeah, I need to go shag a mortal and punish
them. This is all boner killer.
Anyway, so he's like, okay, I'm going to get one of the princes of Troy to decide who gets it. So he goes to Paris, Prince Paris, and he's like, okay, so who's the fairest of them all? Just choose one. I'm sick of it. So Paris, so Athena, Hera, and Aphrodite all promise him different things. I forget what Athena and Hera promised him, but Aphrodite, who's the goddess of love, beauty, and fertility, promises to give him the beautiful Helen of Troy, who was then obviously a Greek. So he goes with her because he wants to get his end wet. So he gives her the golden apple, and pretty much that starts the Trojan War, which then, you know, destroyed Troy. So that is the basic story of the musical I Want to Tell, and it ends with the Trojan War. I wasn't too because with Mamma Mia, it's all centered around a singular sort of musical group. I wasn't too sure which musical group to go with. So what do you guys reckon? Who should
One
I go
Direction.
With?
I was just about to say that.
Yes! We'll get One Direction over.
Oh, God. Okay. I'd love to hear what the audience has to think, but you guys...
You've got that one thing.
Yeah. Okay. One Direction.
One Direction. Okay, sure, whatever. So that's my musical, The Judgment of Paris, it should be called.
Yeah, and the apple could be like some One Direction paraphernalia that they throw, like maybe it's Harry's shirt or something and all the girls are screaming over it. No, totally.
Why aren't I drunk right now?
So, guys, what is the main thing that we've discussed that is makes Mamma Mia famous?
ABBA.
Yes, and I hate ABBA. So obviously, I'm going to take them out of it.
Noticed.
So I decided to take ABBA out of Mamma Mia, and replace them with another better band. I thought one that fit. Originally, I wanted to try The Dead South, but, like, you know, they've only been around for, 8 years. So that would make, like, for the purposes of the story, it would make the main person 8. And I was like, I don't really want to get into, like, you know, child brides and all that. I mean, this play could be set in, in Saudi Arabia, maybe, but no. So I went away from that. So I hope you guys enjoy my version of Mamma Mia called My Chemical Wedding.
Yay! The emo in me is cheering. Wow. Yes! Okay.
So in the shitty town of Ararat, Victoria, Australia, Sophie Sheridan's wedding is a week away. She has everything in order. Most of the guests are already in town praying for the sweet release of death because there is nothing good in Ararat, Victoria, Australia.
I mean, but there's a drug prison there, so...
There's also a pedophile prison there. So, yeah. Something to keep in mind. Oh, no,
yeah, no, it's a sex offender prison.
Yeah.
It's a sex offender prison, not the drug prison. My bad, that's somewhere
so,
else.
So, if you guys, if anyone from America wants to know what Ararat is like, it's like the Jimmy Savile of Australian towns. And Jimmy Savile is basically the British Bill Cosby. So, Sophia wants...
I mean, at least she didn't say George Pell.
But he went there. So Sophia wants her real dad to walk her down the aisle. Not her stepdad, who her mother, Donna Sheridan Carmichael, divorced after finding he installed a camera in Sophia's bathroom, which pointed at a shower. She wants her real dad. She reveals to a friend that she has invited all the men who could be her father. Her friend is a little confused, and Sophia tells her that after a concert of a particular band, her mum went backstage and they had quite the party. Sophia pressed her mum on which man could be, you know, her father. And her mum said, yeah, it's kind of hard to tell because I had all four of them in me at once. It's a key plot point, guys, by the way. A key
This reminds me of that South Park episode.
Yes. Oh, boy.
Okay.
By the way, I got that joke from when I was like 12 years old and we had like a drama class. And we had two guys up there, and they're like, oh, why don't you do a play on practicing safe sex? And they're like, okay. This is like, we're like fucking year seven as well. And these two get up there, and like one of them's like, so I noticed you went to a party last night. He's like, yeah, I did. He's like, did you like at least wear a condom? And the other one, just quick as a fucking fire, just, I don't know, I had 11 in me at once. And the teacher, like, went up there and, like, says, no, no, you're both getting detention.
That's creativity.
Oh, wow. Oh.
So Sophia needs a reason to bring these four men to the wedding. But she does. She's hired them to actually be the band. And she's going to, like, secretly DNA test them while, you know when they're around. So My Chemical Romance arrives in Ararat to play the wedding, and immediately after they land, they're like, you know, we need to get back to that emo music. This is just, it's bringing back all the feelings. So Sophie convinces her friend to sleep with each member and to save the condom so she can DNA test them. But all is not well as Donna accidentally bumps into the band at the hotel they're staying at. So they're basically like they're all drinking at the bar. Gerard Way has resorted to drinking because Ararat is so boring and shit. The band remembers Donna and they say they've never forgotten like how she did that thing with her tongue. Suddenly, all the band members start fighting over Donna and want to get her hand in marriage, which is quite interesting because. From what I could gather from research, most of them are married. Gerard Way begins by writing a comic about her, and just when he's finished it, Netflix decides to make it a TV series. So, well done. Mikey Way kills 12 people and offers their blood to Donna. I couldn't find a lot of Mikey Way's personal life on Wikipedia.
So you just think he's a murderer?
Well, they made a few vampire-type albums. Ray Torrell says that, you know, his wife and his kid mean absolutely nothing to him and he would happily leave them. And then there's the drummer of the band. He does something. Donna is overwhelmed and runs away. Making things worse, Sophie receives the results and they're inconclusive. On the day of the wedding, Donna finds Mike Hem and tells them she loves them all and wants to marry them all. Which is, like, really poor taste to propose, you know, at someone else's wedding. So she should have known that. They hear crying and investigate. It's Sophie, and she tells the members that she secretly DNA tests them when they all slept with her friend to find out who was the father. But the results are inconclusive. And then Gerard Way reveals what possibly happened. Probably all their sperm joined together in the womb, like, into one mega sperm. And then that went into the egg. So, in fact, every member of My Chemical Romance is her father.
They're all the father.
And,
Okay. We're not cats. It doesn't quite work that way.
Yeah, it does now. It does with My Chemical. Yeah. So, okay. All four members of the band walk her down the aisle and she meets her husband who I actually haven't mentioned or written anything about. Let's say is Harry Styles. That'd be good, because if she like does all of One Direction, that can set up the sequel if she gets pregnant. And later that month, all the members of My Chem leave their families and marry Donna. And everyone lives happily ever after.
Yeah, you know, polyamory for the win.
Yeah, it's a very progressive play.
You know what?
Dia, yeah, you look very, Lauren, you look very disgusted.
I think Lauren's used to it by now.
Yeah, no comment.
No.
And if any members of My Chemical Romance want to contact me and make this play happen.
Please don't. Please don't.
Yeah, no. Yes. Let's not.
Okay, Lauren, bring this ship around. Save this entire segment by actually giving us a performance that's not absolutely disgusting.
Yeah, I can try and promise it's not going to be disgusting. I don't think it is. I've kind of gone away from like it being about the music, and rather I just focused on the storyline of Sophie and her dad and her mum. Okay, so it's set in 1920s New York. So think like film noir, gangsters, mafia, femme fatales, all of that kind of stuff, detectives in long coats. And that's the end. No, just kidding.
Fantastic. Good
stuff. Okay.
The story begins with a body being delivered piece by piece to a young woman and her mother's house. And so the young woman is Sophie, a burlesque dancer, and she lives with her mum, Donna, who we don't know what she does. And the body delivered to them is Sophie's father's body.
Oh, there we go. Case closed. Well done. All right, let's get lunch.
And so now that her father's dead, Sophie decides to help her mother by also getting a sugar daddy. So she's a burlesque dancer and she has a sugar daddy.
You were obsessed with sugar daddies.
Not at all. And her sugar daddy's name is Sky, and they fall in love and Sky proposes. But before Sophie agrees to marry Sky, she has some business to take care of. She's not going to rest until she finds out who murdered her father. So she enlists the help of her three best friends, Sam, Harry and Bill, who, of course, have slept with her mother.
Sky. Everyone does. Her mum's a real town bicycle in this.
Yeah.
And in Mamma Mia, apparently.
Sky agrees not to set a wedding date until Sophie finds her father's killer, but after 6 months have passed and there's no leads, Sky decides to follow Sophie to Rome, where she's been staying with distant relatives while she's been looking for the murderer. And so on the arrival in Rome, Sky is greeted by Sophie's mum, Donna, and Donna confesses that she killed her husband. Now she begs Sky not to tell Sophie, and he lies and says that he won't, but instead he hires a private investigator who helps Sophie search for her father's killer. The private investigator comes across some letters hidden inside a corset, and the letters are between Donna and Bill, so Sophie's friend Bill, depicting a sexual encounter that Donna had with Bill, Harry and Sam, which leads the private investigator to consider Donna as a suspect in her husband's murder.
They're just great friends, aren't they?
So great. Mm. And a great mother.
Yeah.
And a cat and mouse chase ensues and the PI attempts to question Donna, but she continuously evades him until finally he catches up with her and the following scene takes place. So Benny, you're going to be the detective. You can put on your worst French accent because detectives always French.
You mean my best
French.
One.
Always.
Dia, you can be Donna. Put on your worst American accent. And I'll be Sophie for the end.
Okay. All right. Guys, can show you how it's done. Oh, ho, ho, ho. Did you do it?
Duh.
How did you get away with it?
He ran into my knife. He ran into my knife 10 times.
Diabolical baguette.
And then I just picked him up off the floor told Sophie to mop up the blood and stuffed his body in the freezer.
And then I need more wine. Bit by bit, and made me believe that he disappeared and you knew exactly what happened all along. Because you murdered him. You murdered Daddy.
Yeah, well, your pa was a nitwit and a boozehound, and not to mention he's probably not your real father anyway.
Well, shite. Oh, that fucking changed fast. I need wine.
I can't do, as someone who dated an American, I can't do American accents. I just can't.
Yeah, American accents are pretty hard.
They are.
I like to think that all of our accents were spot on.
Sure.
I've made the French proud.
I think you've just started a war, actually. But hey, you're all for war and murder, apparently. So
apparently, yeah. Well, I think you guys' American accents were not the best, you know. They have to be more Southern hick.
The Medal of Honor. The Medal of Honor was made of metal.
Oh, brick.
That's all I can do. I can't really do.
All right. Lauren, I really enjoyed the setting change. And I feel that if you write this down, you could get a Tony.
She doesn't need to write it down. She has an idea. She's already won the Tony, apparently.
Yeah.
Oh, of course, yeah.
You just needed an idea. Don't even need to make it.
Aren't our opinions law anyway?
Yeah. There is a legal legislation in the state of Victoria that does specify that our opinions, and only us three, are law. So,
yes, I did a bit of research. The melodramatics law.
It's time for Benji's Weird Fear Now.
Dia, are you ready? Are you ready, Dia? Who lives
for
in
what?
A pineapple under the sea?
SpongeBob SquarePants!
Yeah. SpongeBob the Musical
Does
is based
on the rest of the words?
Exorbitant and yellow and...
Or absorbent.
Coarse is he?
He is.
And if nautical nonsense
he,
be something you wish, then drop on the deck and flop
nautical
like a fish.
Nautical nonsense be something you wish.
Yeah. Okay,
SpongeBob,
beautiful.
SpongeBob
the Musical is based upon the extremely well-known SpongeBob the SquarePants animated television show, which aired on Nickelodeon starting in 1999. Created by marine science educator and animator Steven Hildenberg, the series follows the adventures of one SpongeBob SquarePants, a grill cook for the restaurant Krusty Krab. And I've spelt Krusty Krab wrong. I mean, I don't use a script at all. SpongeBob is a lighthearted and fun-loving character who lives in a pineapple at the bottom of the sea in a town called Bikini Bottom. It took me years to get that one. Of course, SpongeBob isn't the only character of the show. SpongeBob's friends often accompany him on his adventures, and they include Patrick the Starfish, SpongeBob's best friend, who is a little bit dim-witted. Squidward, a squid who is a co-worker of SpongeBob and the person I relate to most, who has a love-hate relationship with the titular character and continually over-exaggerates his own artistic ability. Sandy, a squirrel and an all-round master of physical activities and sciences. Mr. Krabs, an owner of the Krusty Krabs and SpongeBob's money-loving boss. He also has a daughter named Pearl, who is a whale. I don't know how that works.
No, I think I've always thought that, like, he's her sugar daddy. Because he's always giving her money.
I don't think it's a sexual relationship.
I like to think
I think it's legitimately that
sugar daddies don't always
daughter.
Have to be sexual.
Oh, okay. Finally, there is Gary, SpongeBob's super genius pet. It is the fifth longest running American animated series, so naturally it has birthed a franchise which includes movies, video games, merchandise, pretty much anything you can slap the characters on. Do we want to know the top four weirdest SpongeBob merchandises?
Oh, yes.
Yes, we do. Number four.
The SpongeBob toaster.
Oh, yes. I want one.
Yes. So basically, if you get this toaster, yes, it's yellow. My ex used to have one. And basically,
I can see why you left
it. It's yeah. She brought in the fucking SpongeBob like toaster. I'm like, that's it. I'm out. No, it doesn't even work that well. It's a giant yellow toaster that's got like.
Typical.
That's like it's got like SpongeBob's face on it, and it like burns his face into the toast. But yeah, it basically undercooks like most of the bread, and then burns his face onto it.
That's just what you need.
Oh.
Toaster that doesn't work.
Number three.
The full-bodied SpongeBob suit. Kudos for this one. It basically puts SpongeBob's face on your face. Yeah, it puts his face on your chest and then like covers your head in yellow. But kudos because it actually has his tie and pants around where the penis would be. There we go.
Oh, good. I can imagine that would be used in a lot of role plays.
Yes.
Yeah. Not of the PG nature, I'm sure.
Oh, that suit is amazing.
I see it now. There's the suit.
Yeah, am I right? Look at the suit.
Why?
See, if we observe, look at that right there.
Oh my
god. Just imagine shaking it around.
Number two.
A SpongeBob balloon that actually has the nozzle of where you blow up the balloon directly where SpongeBob's penis is.
Oh my god.
Doesn't
That's
take a lot to figure this one out, guys.
Disgusting. Hey. Oh god.
This is also the balloon, by the way, guys.
I understand now.
Ew, it's coming out of his pants. Mm.
Why is it white? If anything, it should be yellow.
Should it be yellow?
I need to have a shower.
Okay.
Number one,
of course, has to be the weirdest product I've ever seen. SpongeBob tampons. SpongeBob Tampax tampons.
What?
Yep.
How?
Yep.
Oh, I mean, he is a sponge, but I don't want to stick it up there. I don't want to stick him up there. That's gross.
I mean, if you love SpongeBob that much.
Look at this girl. She is loving.
I mean, when he comes
those
out,
SpongeBob tampons.
Oh god, I think I've seen them.
In defense of the product, he is a sponge.
Do they work? I mean, do they work well? Is it?
You know, I haven't looked up reviews, and I don't feel I ever will.
She looks too young to be on her period.
That's what I was thinking as well.
Too young to have periods.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, now back on track. Ooh. And of course, they made a musical. SpongeBob SquarePants, the Broadway musical, or as it was originally called, SpongeBob the Musical, and this title was later used for the touring, is directed by Tina Landau of Steppenwolf Theatre Company fame. The book script was created by Kyle Jarreau, and various artists contributed to the music. These artists included Cyndi Lauper, because as long as I'm alive, Cyndi Lauper gets top credit. David Bowie, T.I.,
nice.
The Flaming Lips, that are apparently a very famous band, and I haven't heard of them.
Neither.
John Lennon, John...
Isn't he dead?
Yeah, he came back from the grave to write SpongeBob.
Yes. Fuck's sake.
Imagine there's no Patrick.
Oh,
it's easy if you try. No, John Legend, Steven Tyler and Joe Perry from Aerosmith. So, you know, they did the shit song, apparently.
Aerosmith.
I was going to say, isn't it Aero?
Yeah, not Aerosmith.
Oh, whatever, they're fucking terrible. They are a terrible band.
There's Benji's stupid opinions again.
Yeah.
Should make a part, Benji's stupid opinions. Where
do a collection of them.
Yes.
Yeah.
The only good thing I've ever seen of Steven Tyler was in Two and a Half Men, where, like, the brother, Alan, I think it was, kept saying, like, Steven Tyler moved in next door to their house. And Alan's like, oh, you know, like, when I lost my virginity, I was, like, listening to his music. And at the very end of the episode, Steven Tyler comes into the house, and Alan's like, oh, I'd just like to say I actually lost my virginity to you. And Steven Tyler's like, well, I don't remember it, but the 70s was a real wild time.
Actually, no, the best thing Steven Tyler ever made, thank you very much, was Liv Tyler.
Oh. Because I thought you were going to say, what's that song from Armageddon?
No, that's so weird how it plays, like, during a romantic scene when his daughter is on screen. It's like, it's a bit weird. But then again, in, what was it, Filth? James McAvoy has a sex scene with his biological sister, so it's weird.
And they say my ideas are fucked up. So, guys, what did we think of SpongeBob the Musical?
It was a little bit cringy to watch, but it was kind of decent.
Yeah, I'm going
to
say one of us probably hasn't actually seen the musical. Try to guess who.
Dear.
Tell us a little bit more about the story.
What? Hey, I saw it. I watched most of it. Yeah. No, I dug it. I thought that, you know, I mean, personally, it wasn't my style, but it's definitely fitting with the show's sort of theme, I guess, and the, you know, the comedy of it, and the characters were all fitting. And yeah, I think for a theater adaptation, it was pretty spot on. And, you know, the story itself about, like, yeah, Armageddon, was clever. Yeah, I thought it was a better story than the SpongeBob movie, actually. I preferred it.
Yeah, I actually liked the sort of darker story of, like, the end of days, but I tried so hard, and I really wanted to like this. I just didn't. I found it so boring.
It had a lot of political themes in there too, like, you know, racism and and believing in science. I was like, huh, okay.
Yes. I'm gonna say, like, I thought the casting was dead on, like their voices sounded like beautiful and sounded exactly. But this is one of my issues with it. Okay, SpongeBob, the dude doesn't look like SpongeBob. SpongeBob is a giant sponge, and I understand I didn't like that. Like, I know it would have been very Uncanny Valley if they just, like, put a giant sponge on a guy and had it do facial animations, but it's just a skinny dude on stage.
I liked it. It made the characters more human and more relatable. Like it's not a cartoon. It's a theater performance. We want to see people. You know, I
found that. I've come to see the SpongeBob show and I'm just watching some skinny knacker on stage with a SpongeBob voice. But
even with, like, Patrick and Mr. Krabs and Pearl and Sandy, like, because some of the ensemble were actually, like, the fish were dressed up as fish. And so even Squidward, he had, like, legs, made him look like Squidward. Like,
yeah, it's weird. Like,
I don't know. It felt like there was a lack of effort in that sense.
Yeah. Do you think it was because they were going to have, like, a lot of these dance moves where they had to express themselves that they probably couldn't have the costumes?
Yeah, I get, like, when SpongeBob and Sandy had to, like, climb the mountain, that scene, the way they did that, that would be hard if you were in, like, a massive sponge scene.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wrote, like,
but yeah,
what I wrote down on it was I said, like, I couldn't put my finger on why I don't like it, but I think it's because it is trying to be so much like the show that it sort of doesn't have its own sort of personality. And I wrote that was sort of detrimental to it because I've seen the show before and I've seen the characters and they look a lot better in the animated show. Like, why am I watching this if
I felt that was a good thing that they tried to keep it close to the show. Like, it was still a musical. It still had its own persona, but it was of the show. Like, it wasn't something completely different. Like Spider-Man. Spider-Man felt like it wasn't part of the Spider-Verse in a way, whereas this was definitely SpongeBob universe.
I did, like, write down that if I saw this in person, I reckon I would have loved it. Like, it's high energy. There's constantly things happening. There's jokes coming at you all the time. So I reckon I think that might have been half the problem, was that I was watching it on a recording rather than seeing it live.
Yeah, definitely.
However, I do have some, like, good notes. I really like how they incorporated all the sound effects from the show into all of their movements.
That was clever. Cool. And I like it how it was very, like, meta, like, SpongeBob's like, hello, guy who makes the noises.
Yeah.
That was clever.
I have a little bit, I was actually going to move this into the trivia, I was going to do trivia a little bit later, but a lot of those sound effects were actually done by Foley live. Yeah, clever. So they actually would have someone really down good. In the orchestra pit, and he would do the Foley sounds for them. And that's how they sort of got the timing a lot more better.
Clever. That's really clever. Yeah.
I'd love the girl who plays Pearl is amazing, and like her singing in Money Money is just spot on.
Oh,
yes.
Gary is just awesome.
Just
have a statue of him and just push it on stage every now and again, and then have someone in the fucking wings just make the meow sounds. You know what I would have done even? I would have gone even further with it. I would have had, like, a person in, like, a black suit behind Gary making the meow sounds.
Oh, my God.
I love the bit when they brought in these sort of parts of the show where they're like, you know, it's like 5 minutes later, 1 hour later.
Yeah.
But, yeah, did it with SpongeBob and just out of nowhere, just 50 years later. It's already past the day.
Yeah.
I have a question. Yep. Do we think Sandy was cast as a person of color because of the way that she's treated? Like, the fish are like, go away, you're a mammal, land animal. And they wanted to, like, have someone who could relate to that kind of.
Yeah, I think it was definitely outcasting. To be sort of the message of it. Yeah.
That's interesting. I felt like it was more just on her merits. And
oh, no, she's still a fabulous performer.
Yeah, obviously that's one of the reasons.
Yeah, but no, I never thought of that.
I thought it would have been great if Sandy actually did wear the whole space suit.
Yes.
Pissed off that she didn't. I was like, come on.
It took me a while to figure out who she was because
I mean, it's not a giant starfish. It's not a giant sponge. Put the whole fucking suit on. Like, I mean, you can have the front open. I don't care. That's fine. Just wear the whole thing, man.
Yeah.
Okay, so would we like to know some trivia?
Definitely.
Ethan Slater, during the Chicago performance, he wore a yellow wig to signify that he was SpongeBob. Then when it went to Broadway, he changed his wig to its more natural red color, and it fucking threw me off. Like, I'm thinking, does SpongeBob have hair? I had to, like, bring up a picture. the Chicago production also, Ethan's the main, obviously. He wore the same clothes as SpongeBob. But it didn't translate well on stage.
Mm.
The musical opened to critical acclaim and as tied for the most nominated production awards at the 72nd Tony Awards with 12. And we will be going through them. As I said before, Life Foley was done by Mike Dobson during the pre-Broadway tryout and the Broadway production. Mike Dobson was in the orchestra pit. So during the tour and the TV special that we watched, he actually did them live on stage. So he did them with the cast.
Cool.
Yeah. Its run was sort of cut short because the Palace Theatre had to undergo renovations, and because of that, SpongeBob couldn't sell enough tickets, and it was forced to close. Yes, there's a reference to Fiddler on the Roof during the news broadcast, which I thought was rather funny.
What was the reference?
What was the Fiddler on the Roof reference?
Okay, so when the news reporter is, like, talking to the citizens of Bikini Bottom leaving, if you look at one of the TV monitors behind him, there's, like, one of the fish is, like, fiddling on a roof. Yeah.
Oh, God.
Okay, so it won a lot of awards, and you'd like to hear about some of these awards, wouldn't you?
We would, yes.
So there was like a page, so I had to cut these down. So it's the Drama Desk Awards and the Tony Awards, and I'm just going to count the nominations for the Tony Awards as well. So it was nominated at the Tony Awards for Best Musical, Best Performance by an Actor in a Lead Role, Best Performance by an Actor in a Feature Role Musical, Best Book for a Musical, Best Original Score, Best Director of a Musical, Best Orchestrations, Best Choreography, Best Sound Design, Best Scenic Design, which it actually won Best Scenic Design.
Nice.
Best Costume Design and Best Lighting Design.
Mm.
At the Drama Desk Award, it was pretty much nominated for everything, so I'm just going to go through what it won. It won Outstanding Musical, Outstanding Actor in a Musical, Outstanding Director of a Musical, Outstanding Feature Actor in a Musical, Outstanding Set Design in a Musical. I will say the set was amazing.
It was. And
the special effects, well, like the actual projections in it.
Projections,
yeah. But I don't know, there's just something that just didn't click, and I just didn't enjoy it as much as I wanted to. But then again, won all these awards, beloved by like thousands of people who've seen it. It's continually does its tours. So I must be the one that's wrong on this one. So what do I know?
Can we take a moment?
Sorry?
To appreciate the guy who played Plankton.
He was good.
Yeah. I loved that he was wearing an eye patch.
He was wearing the same outfit, right?
Yeah, he was wearing the same outfit, but he also wore like an eye patch to signify Plankton's one eye.
Yeah.
That wrapping was phenomenal.
Oh,
he had the model impressed of Plankton on his fucking finger.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was so great.
Okay, so guys, final thoughts of the SpongeBob musical. Lauren, what did you think? And what are you going to score it out of 10?
There's definitely room for improvement, I think. I'm in a similar boat to you, Benji. Like, I enjoyed it, but not as much as I wanted to. So I'm going to give it a 6 out of 10.
Okay.
6 sponges out of 10.
Yep. Oh, what?
Oh, I forgot to mention one thing. I can't remember which song it was. Oh, it was the Simple Sponge song. How great was it that they literally just got kitchen sponges out and like, they glowed in the dark?
That was clever.
I had to pause it for a second to like process that's what it was. I was like, oh, right.
I actually remember during that song, like thinking, like as he's saying, like I'm a simple sponge, like going, you know, there's also a contraceptive method called the sponge. And if he's referring to it like that, this song takes on a whole new meaning. Dear, final thoughts. What are you going to give it out of 10?
Oh, how do I follow that? yeah, like I said, I dug it. Like, I didn't really grow up with SpongeBob. I sort of came to it a bit later in life. So I don't really have that sort of love for it that I feel like Benji might have.
I grew up on it, yeah.
Yeah, you too, yeah. So I was a bit more sort of moved back a bit. But I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was entertaining. I actually laughed a few times watching it. I thought like I said, it was very similar to the show from what I'd seen. So saying that, room for improvement, like Lauren said, there's definitely some. I guess I am sort of biased. I didn't really grow up with it. Yeah. Not really a massive fan of it. So I am going to say 5 out of 10.
Oh.
Yeah.
Benji. Yeah. Look, everything technically about it was sound. I loved the live foley. I think there should be more of that actually in stage. Singing, like, I wouldn't complain about any of the songs in it. I wouldn't complain about any of the performances. They're all good. Girl Who Played Pearl was amazing. The acting was fine. I just wish the costumes would have... Like, could you even, like, bulk up his shirt so it is, like, could he wear a shirt that is a sponge?
I mean, he was already pretty bulky.
Yeah.
If you get my meaning.
So, I don't know, but, like, I mean... Other than the fact that I just, I don't know, something didn't click and I just didn't enjoy it, I can't really fault it on anything else. So I'm not going to be like an absolute bitch. I'm going to give it 8 out of 10. Because
I think, wow.
Yeah, like, I mean, if I had kids or if you're a fan of SpongeBob, I'd recommend it. I would recommend just seeing it as a musical because the projections, the singing, the set is all amazing. Like, I don't, even though it was boring, I mean, like, I felt it was boring and I didn't enjoy it. I don't feel like I wasted my time watching it.
Yeah.
You know, like, yeah. So, yeah, those are my final thoughts. And nice. I think that will bring this episode to a close.
Nice.
So I've been joined by the lovely Lauren Hargart.
Aw, thank you.
And bringing up the rear is the lovely Dia Taylor.
Danke schön.
I've been your host, Benji Rag. And remember, you matter.
Bye.
I should be my daddy's greatest prize. But instead, he's got dollar signs.